So for me, it's a pleasure to introduce you to Cristina Reguant. Maybe some of you already know her. She's an academic researcher in our university. She's professor, in fact, of microbiology. Her specialty is the lactic acid bacteria. And she will explain today the results of a project that I was also involved with. So it was a pleasure to work together. And it's about something that happens with the climate change, I would say, and the tendencies that there are of reduce the quantity of sulfites. So the lactic acid bacteria also are in the bottles of sparkling wines in the traditional method. And so we have studied that and in order to avoid this problem. So Cristina, I give you the floor and explain us the results of this project. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much, Juan Miquel. I'm going to share now the presentation. Well, thank you for the introduction and also thank you for inviting me to present these results that are part of our recent research, as Juan Miquel said. Well, this problem of malolactic fermentation in sparkling wines is more and more frequent, also because of, as Juan Miquel said, the climate, the global warming, and especially in those regions where the climate is already warm. So this is what happens where we are now in Tarragona, in general in Catalonia, but also in other regions. Well, just before starting to present the results of the project, let me just explain very briefly an introduction just to put in context the problem. Well, as you know, the malolactic fermentation is a desired process for some types of wines, such as red, but in sparkling wine, because of the increase of pH that represents the decarboxylation of malic acid, this can suppose a problem because of the loss of the freshness of this type of wines, especially, as I said, in warm regions. And as you know, this fermentation, so-called fermentation, because it's only a decarboxylation, it can be done by the lactic acid bacteria present in wine, but mainly, as you know, is performed by the predominant species that is Inococcus oeni. More precisely, those negative effects on the quality of sparkling wine are, of course, this decrease in acidity that I have mentioned, but also the development of this fermentation can produce a slight increase in the pressure, in the carbon dioxide pressure. Also increases the heterogeneity between the bottles, because we have observed that this fermentation may occur in some bottles, but in others not. So there's a problem with heterogeneity of the product here. And also the turbidity that the biomass, the growth of this lactic acid bacteria produce, may also bring difficulties in bottle riddling, what we call remouage. And this might be a serious problem affecting the production. And also it has been associated as one possible cause of what we call guaching. So altogether, not only the acidity, but also other problems might be associated to the development of malolactic fermentation in this kind of sparkling wines. Well, you know, several strategies are available to try to minimize or avoid malolactic fermentation, to stop the growth of lactic acid bacteria in wine. And recently, two compounds, especially one of them is more recent, have been proposed as possible malolactic inhibitors. One is chitosan, but it has been used for a longer time. You know, is a derivative of chitin. that is produced by deacetylation. And it has been proof that is efficient for Brettanomyces, but also it has been proposed as an inhibitor of lactic acid bacteria. And more recently, fumaric acid is another compound that it has shown a great potential as inhibitor of this bacteria too. So our project focused mainly in these two treatments. As you will see, we tried other things, but those two were the main strategies. Just a short reminder of how these two compounds are acting on bacteria, the antimicrobial activity that they have in the case of chitosan. Because of the way it is obtained, that is a deacetylation, this is a polycationic substance that interacts with the bacterial cell wall that is negatively charged. So this chitosan would act as a complementary charge that may lead to the disintegration of the cell envelope. So, and this is more effective in gram-positive bacteria. You have here in this figure, you know, of course, gram-negative and gram-positive bacteria have different types of envelopes. The gram-negative that have this outer membrane, and the gram-positive this thicker peptidoglycan layer. And chitosan is more effective against the gram-positive because this cell wall it's more exposed, it's totally exposed, in fact, to the external medium. And this charge, this positive charge of chitosan and the negative charge of the cell wall may interact and as you see in the figure, may produce the disruption of the cell wall and even the cell membrane. And this means the internal compounds of the cells may be released, of course, cell damage, and even chitosan could bind DNA, which would block DNA transcription and replication of the bacteria. In the case of gram-negative, there's also some interaction, but since there's this outer membrane, the damage might be not so bad. It blocks the nutrient flow, and it can also, in some cases, damage DNA, but it's not so effective. I'm sorry. Apparently, against gram-negative bacteria. So in the case of wine, it would be, of course, more effective against lactic acid bacteria, but not so much against acetic bacteria that are gram-negative. Regarding fumaric acid, well, this is not so well described, the mechanism of action, the antimicrobial mechanism. But the most reasonable hypothesis seems to be the intracellular dissociation of this acid. So this acid would enter into the cell in the protonated form, and then inside would protonate and would cause the acidification of the cytoplasm, which of course means affecting the enzymes, the maturation of proteins, and so. Also, for some bacteria, not lactic acid bacteria, but some bacteria such as Escherichia coli or Listeria monocytogenes, it has been described that fumaric acid may inhibit glutamate decarboxylase system. That is a system that the bacteria have, also lactic acid bacteria have, involved in acid stress resistance. But as I said, this is not so well established. What is well described is that this antibacterial activity of fumaric acid is associated to low pH. There is a synergistic effect. And actually, without low pH, fumaric acid, it's not, it has not this antimicrobial activity. So, and this supports somehow the hypothesis of intracellular dissociation. If you see here the pKa of fumaric acid, and considering the pH of wine, it makes sense that the fumaric acid may enter into the cell in the protonated form, and then it may release these protons inside and cause this acidification. So this these are the, let's say, the hypotheses related to the effect of this compound on lactic acid bacteria. As you also know, both treatments are approved by the OIV, chitosan for longer time ago. You know that chitosan is also used for other applications, such as the reduction of contaminants or iron and copper haze, but also to reduce the undesirable microorganisms, mostly thinking about Brettanomyces, but as you know, also it has been proposed, and there are some commercial products already also for lactic acid bacteria, and also the doses for this kind of application are established. Well, also fumaric acid, and in this case, very recently, last year, it was approved by OIV. In this context of global warming, and also with the aim of reducing the levels of sulfur dioxide additions, fumaric acid seems to be a powerful inhibitor, of malolactic fermentation. So, and after all the research that has been done with this compound, OIV approve its use in doses that go from 300 to 600 milligrams per liter for the control of malolactic fermentation. So it's a new tool to minimize this process when it's not desired. Well, so this is the context of the problem. And as I said, I will explain the main results of a project, a recent project that we were working on, about the minimization and looking for solutions of undesired malolactic fermentation in sparkling wines. And in this project, well, several people were involved. Joan Miquel is one, also Daniel Fernandez, Albert Bordons, and Fernando Zamora. And as you see here, this was a project in association with several sellers, Codorniu, Castillo de Perelada, and Vallformosa. And also we had some support from Laleman, as in this case, providing some enological products. Well, the objective of the project, I think it's already evident. It was, as I said, finding solutions, designing an efficient protocol to minimize the development of malolactic fermentation during sparkling wine production. We are in a region that we have cava wine, that is a type of sparkling wine, and we were working with the sellers, trying to optimize a protocol using different strategies. But very briefly, the work plan was defined, but let's say two strategies. One was performing pilot scale trials in the cellar to test different treatments to minimize malolactic fermentation. We could do this in the harvest of 2018, 19, and 20, with the pandemics in between, which make as a bit difficult, and we had to repeat some of the trials, but in the end we got some nice results, I think. And, well, these trials, we followed two strategies. Mainly, we did vinification assays, meaning that we were using the treatments from the beginning, in the must, in the grape must. And also we tried tirage assays, so with the treatments in the moment of tirage of the bottles. In parallel also, we perform an exhaustive sampling of bottles that were provided by the sellers, bottles that where malolactic fermentation had been detected. So we analyzed these bottles, both chemical and microbiologically, and trying to understand if there was some kind of relation, and also to see the populations that were there and characterize them. So I start to explain this, this selection of main results. I start with the vinification assays. We did besides the results that I'm presenting here, we did other trials, trying other strategies besides fumaric acid and chitosan. We also tried the use of some yeast, such as Lactancia thermotolerance and other strategies, but I'm just showing those that gave better results and I think are more interesting. So this here is one example of these vinification assays. We, in this case, started from grape must, in this case of the variety Parellada. And we tried in the cellar, the experimental cellar that we have in our university, the treatment with fumaric acid with 30 grams per hectoliter, in this case, chitosan, 20 grams per hectoliter, and sulfur dioxide, 6 grams per hectoliter. In this case, the control condition was with, let's say, a low addition of sulfur dioxide, around 3 grams per hectoliter. And we used a standard yeast for the fermentations. And we divided two batches of the fermentations. And in one of the batches, divided, as I said, the fermentations. And then in one of these batches, we inoculated with Enococcus oeni, with a strain of Enococcus oeni, at a population of 10 to the 4 cells per milliliter. In this case, in order to simulate what it would be the contamination of a high population of lactic acid bacteria, let's say a must with a high biomass of lactic acid bacteria. The other batch was not inoculated, so the objective was to check the efficiency of the treatments under these two conditions, with a higher amount of cells of lactic acid bacteria, and in the other case, just with the indigenous population that the must might have. Well, in this case, we just performed the alcoholic fermentation, and then the wines were stored during a short period of conservation, and then they were process and we did tirage and after the second fermentation aging. Well, regarding the first fermentation, you see here the data of the alcoholic fermentation, the density, the decrease, which is the same for all the conditions. This regarding the treatment and the fact that was inoculated or not with lactic acid bacteria. And on the right, the yeast population, which is also very similar, just a slight differences. So in this first alcoholic fermentation, we didn't observe any difference between among the treatments. We monitor during this period after the alcoholic fermentation and before the tirage that, as I said, there was a period of conservation at low temperature of these wines. We monitor the populations of lactic acid bacteria and also the consumption of malic acid to see if these treatments were efficient a long time. As you see here on the left, the lab populations, the lactic acid bacteria populations after alcoholic fermentation were already high for those cases that were inoculated with the Enococcus oeni strain, it was expectable, especially, of course, the control condition with lower sulfur dioxide, but also with higher concentration of sulfur dioxide and chitosan, especially, we can see that the populations were increasing in time, whereas the rest of the conditions, the populations are lower, and this includes also the treatment with fumaric acid inoculated with lactic acid bacteria. So, and we can see in the consumption of malic acid during this period before tirage, in these cases where the populations were higher, of course, we could observe related to this, the consumption of malic acid in some cases, all the malic acid in others, part of it, especially for the conditions with sulfur dioxide. But I insist in those cases that were inoculated with bacteria. So this is something that we could expect. So these treatments are decreasing the efficiency a long time. Then we made the tirage and the second fermentation. And here you have again the in this case, sorry, the pressure increase. And you see how it's, let's say there are no big differences, no significant differences among conditions with or without inoculation of Enococcus oeni in general. We can see here in the first graph that the control is a bit higher than the rest treated conditions, but in general, no big differences in this case with the second fermentation. Well, after this, we monitor the bottles during aging, and we were sampling every month or every few weeks. And what we could observe is that after some months, in all the treatments in the end, there was some consumption of malic acid. Some of them we already saw that started before the tirage, the consumption of malic acid, but the rest of them, a long time, we could see that malolactic fermentation happened. So we can say that the inhibitory effect of these compounds might have lost some activity capacity, some activity a long time. We can also say that the addition of fumaric acid was the most persistent treatment, although in the end also decreased, probably because it decreased the concentration. And also in these conditions, the malolactic activity happened. So all these results bring up the question if maybe the addition of these treatments is better in another points of the process, such as the tirage. So this is the reason why we perform also some assays starting from the tirage to see if these treatments were more efficient from that point. So as an example of this kind of assays, the tirage assays, here you have some of the conditions that we tried using again just a standard yeast for the second fermentation in the tirage. And in this case, testing a treatment with fumaric acid and chitosan in the same concentrations that I mentioned before, and a control condition just with a low concentration of sulfur dioxide. We, in this case, tried several inoculation conditions. That means a control condition without any inoculation of lactic acid bacteria, of Enococcus oeni. But then we tried different populations, 10 to the second, 10 to the fourth, and 10 to the sixth, just to see to see more precisely the efficiency of these treatments in these different starting conditions of population of lactic acid bacteria. I didn't mention before, but the strains that we use, the Enococcus strain that we use for this kind of trials, had been isolated from sparkling wine. And we have observed, I will talk a little bit about this later, that these strains behave a little bit differently than other strains, for example, isolated from red wine. They seem to be more resistant. So we did all these trials with, as I said, strains that had been isolated specifically from sparkling wine. So probably more adapted to this medium. Well, we did all these trials with the different conditions, tirage and the aging. And regarding the second fermentation, the second alcoholic fermentation, here you have the four conditions in relation to the population inoculated. We could see some differences here. You see the not inoculated condition, well, it was similar, the pressure increased in a similar way for the three conditions here, without treatment, with fumaric acid and with chitosan, in this case represented with a Q in blue. But then in the conditions that were inoculated with lactic acid bacteria, you see here with the arrows that the pressure didn't increase so fast and it didn't reach a value as high as the rest. And we can see this especially at highest population of lactic acid bacteria that had been inoculated. we further investigated this phenomenon. I'm not showing more data, but we did other trials, even adding a higher concentration of chitosan. I didn't mention that maybe that the pressure is lower here using the condition of chitosan here. So we did more trials with different concentrations, higher concentrations of chitosan, and we could confirm this effect of decrease of the pressure when we compare to the control condition. And what we saw is that chitosan in this second fermentation and added at this point of tirage might be affecting the yeast population, inhibiting somehow, in some manner, the yeast population, and this would promote the development of lactic acid bacteria, especially in those cases where the population is high of this bacteria. So this is, of course, something that is not desired. It's the opposite that we wanted. So in this case, at least use at this point of the process, the chitosan didn't work so well. There were no differences for fumaric acid. The second fermentations work fine as in the control. And then after this, we also sampled the bottles a long time. I'm showing here just the analysis after 1 year of the tirage. And very briefly, you see here the two treatments, fumaric, chitosan, and the control condition. And both in the control condition and the chitosan-treated wines, there was consumption of malic acid in some cases, more in others less. The initial malic acid was around 2 grams per liter. And you see that it was partly consumed during this time. And this correlates well with the production of L-lactic acid. Instead, in the case of fumaric acid treated wines, you see here that the concentration of malic acid was retained and it wasn't barely consumed. It's close to the original value, around 2 grams per liter, almost no production of, or no detection of L-lactic acid. And we also isolated the population of lactic acid bacteria. These results are a little bit random because, of course, 1 year later, maybe the malolactic fermentation has been produced or partly produced, but maybe the bacteria are already dead because it happened months ago, or maybe the cells are in a viable but not culturable status. So this is also possible. So you see here that, for example, in some wines of the control condition, we could detect population of lactic acid bacteria after 1 year, also in some of the conditions with chitosan, and in others we don't detect any population just because of this, but maybe because the consumption was earlier. What is clear is that for fumaric acid, we didn't detect, in any case, a population of lactic acid bacteria. And as I said, there was no malolactic fermentation after 1 year. So it seemed to be quite efficient, this treatment when used in the tirage. Well, we did also some sensory analysis here just for the conditions without inoculation with lactic acid bacteria. I'm just going to say that in all cases, both fumaric and chitosan, no deviation, relevant deviations from the control condition. So from the organoleptic or the sensory point of view, it seems that any of the treatment was altering the final wine. And there are other studies that are pointing to this. So this was a good result. And in parallel to these assays in the cellar, we also did all this sampling that I mentioned of bottles that had been detected, the malolactic fermentation that the cellars provide us. And from these bottles, we isolated the population of lactic acid bacteria and tried to characterize it. So what we obtained, different number of colonies coming from different bottles, different cellars. And what I'm showing here is just, let's say, a sample of what we found. For example, you have here the graph on the left, that is the diversity of strains that we could find in the colonies isolated in two different cellars. These colonies had been isolated and typified by molecular methods, so we could establish that first all of them were Enococcus oeni. We can check this by molecular methods, by PCR. And then after, there's another molecular method that is this variable number of tandem repeats that allows us to distinguish the type of strain, so the different strains, analyzing the genome of this bacterium. So you see here just the comparison of samples taken from two cellars, that there's quite a lot of diversity. Each color means a different type of strain. Some of them are more abundant. You can see we can find higher number of colonies belonging to some of the strains. Some others are present, but in low numbers. And what is also interesting is that we could find, in some cases, the same strain in the two different cellars. That is something that we have also seen for other kind of wines. So there are some strains that seem to be better adapted, and we can find them in different cellars. You see on the right here some other data regarding the typification of strains. In this case, what we did is to monitor the process, to take samples from different steps of the process, be the coupe, the liquor, the derived liquor, the filtered wine used for the second fermentation, the derived, and the sampling during aging. Well, you see here that in this case, in this process that we monitor and that I'm showing here, we could find an increasing number of lactic acid bacteria, an increasing number of isolated colonies during aging, so towards time, but we could find colonies in all the steps, so from pied de coupe, even in the filtered wine. And you see that there's some kind of diversity. We could see different strains. As I said before, some are more abundant than others, but it seems that lactic acid bacteria might be in all the steps, at least that we took in this sampling during the process. Well, with all these isolates, we got a collection of strains isolated from sparkling wine, and we characterized some of them. I'm just showing one example. What we did, just to see if they were more or less resistant to different treatments, and is to compare these to other strains, red wine. Just an example with one strain from red wine, that is PSU1, and another strain of Enococcus oeni isolated from sparkling wine, inoculated both in synthetic wine, and trying different treatments of fumaric acid, chitosan, and sulfur dioxide. You see here that we tried here higher concentrations of fumaric acid and also chitosan. Just they were so. This so-called wine strain, this PSU1, it was inhibited by all the treatments, only the control condition performed the malolactic fermentation. But instead, you see here this example of sparkling wine strain that it was resistant to some of the treatments, especially to sulfur dioxide, but also to the lowest concentration of chitosan. Instead, it was inhibited by the two concentrations of fumaric acid and the highest concentration of chitosan. This is just an example, but we saw a similar behavior in different strains. So it seems that these strains are or can be more resistant to some of the treatments than others. Well, just to finish, during this project, we had also the opportunity of developing and optimizing a methodology of a fast analysis of fumaric acid, so we can monitor if the concentration persists or not in the different assays. based on an enzymatic method. In this case, it's based on the use of fumarase that transforms fumarate into malate. And then from here, you can use just regular elements that, that are in a commercial enzymatic kit for the analysis of L-malic acid. So it was an adaptation of this method, but that, as I said, it allows us to monitor the concentration of fumaric acid. Well, this methodology has been already published in ONO1 journal, so you can find it here. And just let me finish with just the main conclusions that I have been already explaining, but we can say that something that's important is that lactic acid bacteria seem to be from the early stages of the production. So there is a latent risk, let's say, from the beginning. Fumaric acid seems to be the best treatment to prevent malolactic fermentation at different times. We have also to optimize which times are better. But it seems that, for example, in tirage, it's quite effective. We didn't observe any effect on fumability due to the addition of fumaric acid. And also these strains that seem to contaminate this process of sparkling wine, in some cases seem to be more resistant to some treatments, but we can say that according to our results, fumaric acid is effective in the inhibition also of these strains. So the perspectives, because we would like to continue the research in this field, would be to better optimize the treatment with fumaric acid to understand and, or to establish which would be the best time of the addition, the concentrations. And another aspect that it's important to understand and to improve is the solubilization of fumaric acid, because fumaric acid is very insoluble. And insoluble in water, as you know, it's quite soluble in ethanol, but it's a problem because for the addition, so it's something that we are trying to optimize also to implement this kind of treatment. So these are the main conclusions and a little bit what we think that it would be interesting I wanted to put the last slide. What we would like to continue investigating. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope it was clear, the presentation, and if you have questions, of course, I'll try to answer them.
Thank you, Cristina. I don't know if someone has a question about that.
Maybe I can start. Thank you very much for the presentation. It was really, really clear and a well-designed experiment. I was wondering, I mean, you were mentioning at the beginning that this is due to climate change, basically. So the wines are less acidic, probably, and so the strains of lactic acid bacteria can grow better. Do you have a feeling on how big this problem is in the industry, or how what's the percentage of that?
Well, what we know is that this is increasing for sure. And here, that, as I said, in the Cava region in Catalonia is a real worry of the sector. I couldn't tell a percentage because maybe sometimes the sellers don't say they have that. But it's true that that more and more they are asking about this, and they are, of course, interested. Well, I think that it's significant that here in this project, three of the big sellers, producers of sparkling wine in our area, were very interested in this project and finding solutions. And of course, is something that it will go probably towards.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thanks. I've seen there's a question also from the chat. So what do you think of the use of the efficacy of lysozyme would be compared to fumaric acid and chitosan?
Okay. Well, with lysozyme, what we have observed is that the persistence is not so good. So it seems that it can stop or inhibit temporarily the malolactic fermentation, but a long time, and sparkling wine is a process that, because of aging, needs months of finish. So it's something that I think it might be risky. So it seems that it's more effective some treatments such as the fumaric acid in for this kind of wine.
Matthias.
Yeah, thank you very much for that really interesting presentation. I was wondering, did you also investigate the role of temperature here? So from our trials concerning fermentation efficiency, we were really impressed how big the effect of temperature could be. Or do you have in general a recommendation in terms of temperature?
But do you mean temperature in the control of temperature in the fermentations, you mean?
Or yeah, so to have, or in other words, we know that temperature for sure has an effect on the malolactic bacteria. So another strategy could be to find a specific temperature regime to avoid malolactic occurring.
Yeah, that could be. I mean, we use standard conditions, standard vinification condition with control of temperature in each step, but we didn't have time to try different temperatures. But it's something that it could be another factor. But still, these strains seem to be quite resistant to some conditions that really are quite harsh. Because it's not only about the ethanol and the pH, but also the pressure. And I mean, there are two yeast fermentation in the process, but still it seems that they are able at some point, they might be there in low populations, probably waiting the opportunity to grow. And so, well, of course it's something that could be checked and maybe it would help, but as I said, there's a problem here that the lactic acid bacteria from the beginning, and it seems that they find a way to increase the population and do the fermentation.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, Marek, as you want, when you want.
Yeah, thanks, Cristina, for a really interesting talk. And I can attest that in South Africa, we've also seen one or two producers that are having problems with LAB. So obviously the first question is, do you think if you look at the three different cellars that you monitored over time, and cellar three that has quite a big change in numbers, do you think that is connected to a specific point in the matrix that allows the bacteria, as you said, they're waiting for an opportunity? And can we pinpoint that opportunity? Is it because all sulfur is bound? Or because if you look at the numbers beforehand, they were quite low, and then at some point at 4 months, 6 months, it's really like a spike in the numbers. Do you have any indication if there's a pH shift at that stage or anything else that can give us a clue on what's happening in the matrix? And the second thing is, if you think about the management, where do you think the most important critical time point is to actually determine whether you have a problem or not, or is that not possible at all with the research you've done? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Well, regarding the first question, we don't have a clear answer yet. One of the things that we try to do is to compilate a lot of data from the historics of the cellars that they have all the monitorization of the samples, analysis, and everything from different years, and where they detected malolactic fermentation. But I must say that this was hard, and we couldn't really find a clear clue that explain a common factor that could say, okay, this happens every time that there is this factor, there is this this pH or this. So it's something that for sure it's not easy, but it should be the objective to understand which factors are going to be critical and why these populations that are, as I said, in low quantities, at some point they are able to increase and perform malolactic fermentation, and why in some bottles they do and in others not. That is, this is something that it's curious that it happens in some of the bottles and others not. So we don't really have the answer yet, but we will work to try to find these relevant factors, because of course this will give us many tools to solve the problem. And regarding the second question, I'm not so sure if I understood what was.
So, according to you, is the best management practice for a producer to actually implement either fumaric acid or chitosan as a strategy?
Okay.
Where do you think, or does it need to be happened throughout the process?
You mean which is the best strategy, I would say?
Yeah.
Well, for our data, it seems that fumaric acid is more effective. And also the chitosan, as I explained, what also caught our attention is the fact that in some cases may affect foamability. So in this case of sparkling wine, this is something risky, especially if it's used in the tirage step. So,
okay. Have you seen any, because in South Africa, one or two of the farms have seen very specific places in the bottle where they actually have where the lactic acid bacteria grow. It's not like a sediment in the bottle, but through riddling, it has a round thing somewhere in the neck or somewhere on the side. So it's very random where you actually see growth. How does it look in Spain if you have bottles that are impacted by the growth of the bacteria? Is it more sediment to the bottle, or do you also have these patches where growth actually happens in the bottle? Because we at a stage thought there's a bottle defect that actually allows the bacteria to aggregate some rough surface in the bottle, but we've had the bottles analyzed as well, and it's not. So there must be something that keeps the bacteria like a biofilm in a little place in the bottle, but I'm not sure if you've seen the same.
I couldn't tell, honestly.
Okay.
But it's something that we are going to look at, because we didn't think about looking at the bottles and the aspect. Of course, you can, well, we assume that there will be an increase in turbidity, but what you say, that the possibility that there is some kind of biofilm formation that may promote the survival of this bacteria, and that's something that we're going to take into account for future assays.
Sorry. Some producers have been reporting that there is, when this happens, there is some floating, films, or not really films, some solids that are floating in the water, and that impedes the remouage. So, but it has been reported by some producers.
Okay. Good to know we're not the only ones that have these floating films.
Yeah, and that is quite tricky, yeah.
No, it's not easy. So, but yeah, thanks, Cristina, and good luck. We look forward to your unraveling and understanding this for all of us. But yeah, it's interesting work.
Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you very much for this interesting presentation. I have just one question, and it's about the fumaric acid. it's the formic acid, it's always stable, biological stable during the wine process. Did you check the quantities of the formic acid during during the aging of the wines to check if it's stable?
Yeah, that's a good question. This is something to do. That's why also at the end of the project, we look for this fast method or easy method of quantification, because we did some trials with HPLC to quantify fumaric acid, but it was a bit complicated because there was some overlapping of peaks. And we didn't get to analyze the samples of these assays that I show here, but for sure is something that we would like to do in the future, because fumaric acid, of course, it's a metabolite of yeast also. So who knows what happens if yeast can uptake it. And also, well, this is something that we would like to explore that we haven't, but it has been described that maybe some lactic acid bacteria have fumarase activity. So I don't know really about this. We didn't check anything, even the genomes that we could check and see if there's described some gene, fumarase gene. But it's something to check, of course. And the new tool to analyze the fumaric acid, for sure, it will tell us if this compound, when added, persists or disappears, and who knows if yeast or lactic acid bacteria, maybe they can metabolize a part of it, or it depends on the strain. We don't know. Okay. But for sure, there's the possibility.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Can I ask another little question? I don't know. I mean, the OIV approved fumaric acid for wine last summer. Are wineries using it, or is someone already commercializing fumaric acid for oenological use as an additive they are aware of, or someone in the meeting? I mean, I'm not aware of it, but it has been almost a year now, so I wonder if fumaric acid will become, it's possible to buy it from someone and to try it, because that will give us a lot of answers from this question if people start to try it for long-term effects.
There is some companies of additives are starting to sell the fumaric acid. For example, what we have that in the next project that we want to try to apply this product, we have been talking with Rabago Chemicals, that is I think is an international company. And they are selling the fumaric acid, but what they have explained us is that there is not so much fumaric acid, because has been a problem. There is a problem about the production or something like that. I don't know if about the raw material that they use or the process that nowadays there's not a lot in the market of fumaric acid. But one advantage, for example, in front of lysozyme is that is, besides that is more, it resists more the you can find it along the time, is the cost. So it's cheap, it's not very expensive. It seems a good thing.
Just to say something about the fumaric acid in Europe, I don't know really if some company starts to produce it, but in the United States you can find it already. I don't know the name of the companies, but some wineries use it since some years, this fumaric acid, especially also for acidification issues.
It's a common acidulant for other foods, so yeah,
but it's not allowed now for in the EU or your IV.
Yes, so I know.
I know that some people are doing some research about that, about the use as a acidifier, now it's not allowed as a to acidify, I would say.
maybe in the future.
Okay, so thank you very much, Cristina. I think this was an interesting topic and a new molecule that could help us in the frame of the new Oenology to decreasing the sulfur as a substitute to the sulfur dioxide. Also about the climate change, but so thank you very much. I think that's all. If anyone has any question, please you can talk now, or if not, we will finish. Okay, so thank you very much, everybody, and see you in the next.